Welcome to Insight. Today we are chatting with Tom Martin, President and CEO of the American Forest Foundation. The American Forest Foundation works on the ground with families, teachers, and elected officials to promote stewardship and to protect our nation's unique forest heritage. Tom has generously agreed to share some of his experience with us. I'd like to thank you, Tom, for joining us today.
It's great to be here, Mark.
The forests in the United States have a long history from our founding of having a dominant role within our society, our economy, our ecosystems. Talk about the role of American forests in America.
Yeah, the forests in a lot of ways have defined how we've grown as a country, what economies have developed, and frankly, they're the cornerstone of our natural environment. From that landscape that the first people that came across the land bridge found that was incredibly forested, we hit it pretty hard for a bunch of centuries. And it's interesting, for the last 100 years, we've got about the same amount of forest now as we did 100 years ago. I think at some point we had real buyer's remorse, or I guess clear cutter's remorse, when we took this cut over land and said, wait a minute, enough, let's restore it. Too important to leave it like it is.
It's a regional phenomena, but it's a regional phenomena that has played out in both tragic and also very optimistic circumstance, so that you saw the clear cutting of the Adirondacks, you saw the clear cutting in the American West of vast redwood strands for whole decades. And then at a certain point, there's a sensibility that turns around when people turn around and they see the forest that they've grown up with no longer there.
Yeah, and it's interesting because you're exactly right. Those places got cut over. Many others did. The upper Midwest was cut over. And what happened is as the trees came back, people had an incredible degree of protection, a sense of protection for it, that these forests were so much a part of their lives that they wanted to make sure that they remained as forests. And that's evolved in a lot of interesting ways, as you reference, in the United States.
Talk about how the American Forest Foundation was created, and talk about your members.
Yeah, so it was created in the 40s, and World War II was just beginning to ramp up, and people had as almost an open sore in their mind what had happened 50 years before when America's forests had been cut over, and they saw the ramping up of this industrial machine and said, wait a minute, we're really worried about our going back to the days of overusing our forests. And this was back in the 40s, right?
And there's a war effort on, there are crises. You've just been able to come out of the crisis, the 25-year crisis of the Great Depression. Mm-hmm. So there are a lot of challenges at that point, but even there you have this ecological sensibility, this environmental conservation sensibility expressing itself in the face of a great danger to the world civilization.
Exactly, and so folks at that point said, I remember what it was like when those trees were gone. I don't want to go back there. And there was real pressure put on the government and the forest products industry to say, wait a minute, we need to make long-term stewardship available for all of our forests. And yeah, Teddy Roosevelt and his successors protected some big chunks of land, and that's great. And the Forest Service got started, and that's great. But most of our land, forest land's privately owned.
Right.
What are we going to do to protect that privately owned land? And it was in that question that the American Tree Farm System was born. And it came together initially as a way of, let's recognize people who are doing great stewardship. Let's help them tell their stories to their neighbors, and let's use an education and outreach strategy so that these landowners who love their land have the tools to be good stewards.
And there are 80 to 90,000 families that are involved in this?
In the American Tree Farm System, yeah. It's about 23 million acres. They managed to an internationally accredited certification standard.
And what does the American Tree Farm Service do?
So, most importantly, what it does is give people the tools to be good stewards on their land. People don't all own land for the same reason, but they all love it for the reason they own it. And there's this there's this incredible attachment people have to that place on the earth that they own, and they care very deeply about it. And some people own it because they want a place to hunt. Some people own it because they want a place to walk in the woods with their grandkids. Some people own it because they want to make a few bucks by selling their trees. But they care deeply about it, and the thread that runs through it is a sense of stewardship for their next generation. Many of them had the land gifted to them by others in their family, by their fathers or their grandfathers or their grandmothers. And they've got this sense that they're stewards for the next generation. So the tree farm system is these folks working with each other, helping learn what's the best practice. If you want more deer, you ought to try this and this. If you want cleaner water, maybe you set back a little farther here. And so it's those folks sharing with each other the best tools, and then the research that we're able to either do directly or get from others, and give that to them so that they can try things out and see what works best.
So in a sense, it's like a Farm Bureau type of sensibility, but for a long-term stewardship of the land.
Yep.
And allowing these families to think about not only their long-term stewardship, but also fulfilling their short-term needs without damaging their long-term interests.
It's a great way of putting it. You know, it's interesting. Landowners, the good news is we've got 80,000 in the system, as you mentioned. The bad news is there's 4.7 million that have parcels of 10 acres or more, where people ought to be thinking strategically about what's my goal for the land. At this point, only 1% are certified, 5% have a written management plan, 15% have ever talked to a natural resource professional. But during the 25 years they own the land, most of them cut. And so that means most of them cut without thinking strategically about that long term that you've just talked about. So we want to talk to those folks about, you've got your goals for the land, that's great. Let's help you figure out how you don't sacrifice that long-term goal that you've got for your land for short-term things.
And perhaps we should also think about sacrificing something for the benefit, for our long-term benefit and the long-term benefit of our children. We seem to have a sensibility in this country that we can fight wars and we can take positions without sacrificing just about anything. And as soon as there's a sacrifice made in terms of changing our own lifestyle, behaviors, our own economic welfare, that is used as a reason to not provide the type of stewardship or the type of engagement that is required to achieve the objective that we would wish to be achieved for ourselves.
You know, it's interesting. I think there's another piece of it as well, and that is managing these forests against these threats takes investment dollars.
Right.
Ensuring that there are markets in place so that you can go in and afford to treat and manage those forests so they're resilient against the attack of pests, of climate change, and for those things that are stressing them. So for instance, you look at the Forest Service. Not even just the Forest Service. Let's take a look at the Front Range of Colorado. Lodgepole pine has been, you know, the cornerstone species there. And the mountain pine beetle, which is an endemic creature, but because we don't have long, cold winters anymore, has begun to run amok. It's killed that whole forest along there. Now, what do you do if the mountain pine beetle hits someplace? The only thing you can do is go in very quickly and remove diseased trees.
Right.
The only way you can afford to do that is if you have a market for those trees. We've got to make sure that we're continuing to develop markets so that we can afford to do the kinds of treatment to the forests that allow them to be resilient in the face of climate change, pests, and pathogens.
And the more we learn about how our weather works, our ecosystems work, our economy works, the more important this type of long-term stewardship really is.
Absolutely, and the statistics are pretty striking. Half Americans get their drinking water filtered by a forested landscape.
As long as you drink the water, you're going to care about the forests.
80 to 90% of the terrestrial threatened and endangered species spend part of their life cycle on a forested landscape. Carbon, According to the president last week, he said 16% of the annual carbon emissions in this country are soaked up by America's forests. And he suggested if we did things a little differently, you might even be able to double that. And it's a million good-paying rural jobs in America that comes out of the forest products industry.
And then the advance of technology has also had a major impact.
Yeah, it's amazing. I think a lot of us have this notion of the forest products industry through the picture, a sepia tone picture, two guys with funny hats standing on
either
two
side
ends
of a large saw.
Yeah, exactly. And it's incredibly different than that today. Even simple sawmills are incredibly computerized so that most of the log is used, almost all of it, and then the remains get used for biomass energy. So there's much more technology involved in the use of wood in forest products. But the other thing that's interesting is that now we're breaking the trees down to its cellulosic fiber. And it's being used anything from women's hosiery to the plasma screen TVs, even as filler in drugs. And so the uses of a tree have also evolved enormously.
So for the future, what is important for Americans to know? And how is it important for Americans to become involved in their daily lives in behaving in a way that encourages the growth of forests and encourages the welfare of forests?
Yeah, so we get all these wonderful things from forests. That's the good news. The bad news is our forests are facing kind of a perfect storm of events. There's 1,000 bugs and diseases that have either come from overseas or were once in check, but as climate have changed, have begun to do real damage. Every summer, it seems to be worse and worse, and in fact, it is in many ways, the catastrophic fires. Not the small, low-level fires that forests have endured for years and in fact adapted to, but the big catastrophic ones that wipe out big swaths of our forests. We've seen enormous drought. Texas, boy, their forests got hammered. They had 3 years of drought. Seen flooding, the hardwood forests along the Mississippi River have seen repeated flooding and damage from that. So you've got these forests that give us all these benefits, but they are under siege from all of these things. So what can people do about that? I think there are a couple things. First, all of us can advocate for policies that allow forests to remain as forests and allow them the flexibility to meet the needs as these threats arise. I think a second thing is, if you own a piece of land, you don't necessarily have to have a written management plan, but you should know, what is it that I love about my land? Why do I care about it? And what should I be worried about if I still want to hold on to those things? There's an awful lot of free consultation that the Extension Service offers, that state forestry agencies offer through the stewardship program, and frankly, the American Tree Farm System offers landowners. Ask for advice. Nobody's going to tell you how you should manage your land, but what we can tell you is how to manage better for the long term.
There are a lot of groups that work on American forests. What's different about what you do at the American Forest Foundation?
It's wonderful that there are so many organizations that are focused on the health of America's forests, looking at the science base of it, trying to figure out what we need to do against all those threats we've talked about. But since most of the American forests are privately owned and most of those by families, unless we can figure out how to reach those people and understand the folks that own those forests and make management decisions every day, we're never going to be able to have the kind of healthy, long-term, sustainable forests we want. So the American Forest Foundation, we invest more in understanding the people that own the forest, what their motivations are, and what are the barriers that are keeping them from better stewardship than other folks do. Other folks can provide deep content on how to make the forest healthy. What we hope to be able to do is understand the people that make those management decisions and help them be better stewards.
How do you ensure that people across various bounds of economic wealth or race or ethnicity are aware and are supportive.
Family forest owners tend not to be any richer than anybody else. They just choose a lifestyle where they're able to do to own some land that has trees on it. And so it's interesting. They're not much different in some ways than urban folks, middle class folks. But figuring out how we help urban people make the connection between a working forest that's changing, growing dynamically, and the need to keep that as a working forest and how that's relevant to their life is really important. And I think, again, I think we've got to figure out how to make those ties to clean water, to clean air, to wildlife, and to our economy much more palpable. And frankly, we in the forest sector have not done a very good job of telling that story, of making those ties clear enough so that all of us feel a sense of urgency about the forest.
And in part, this is the work of the American Forest Foundation.
It is the work of the American Forest Foundation.
Well, Tom Martin, thank you so much for sharing your work with us, and thank you so much for your insights.
Thanks. Great to be here.